gentlemen, please welcome our next speaker, Mr. Robin Banerjee, Managing Director, Caprians India Limited. May I request you to please join us on the stage, sir.
I would like to call upon Dr. Suresh Chandra Patil, Director BIIB, to welcome our guest with a bouquet.
Speech like this takes place where most speech is one-sided, which means it's a monologue. And I hope you know the definition of monologue. Definition of monologue? You don't know the definition. I can assure you. No, definition of monologue is I talk and you sleep. And before lunch, that's an apt position for a monologue. But it would be wonderful if you can have a talk. Which means we can continue to interact as I'm going on. Because sky is the limit. You do get opportunities for business corporate people come once in a while, people like us, and share our thoughts. And what thoughts can we share? Because it is unlimited. The world, the corporate world is unlimited. There is no end. There is no that one answer which defines success. So what is it that one should talk about? And maybe I'll just ask two ideas that when a speaker like this comes in front of you and when he's standing, and the institute has not defined us or has not told us this is what we need to speak, this is a topic. They said, you speak what you want. I think that's a great opportunity. Any thoughts? Why is it that you are requesting people like us standing here and talking to you? Any objective? Any particular deliverable? Anyone wants to share? Just one sentence? Anyone? What do you think? What do you want us to do?
Get the present scenario in the corporate world.
To get the present scenario in the corporate world is one requirement, one desire. And if that is fulfilled, you are happy with the so-called give a lunch. Any other one?
Interactive.
Interactive? You want to interact with corporate world. What else?
For example, someone is coming from the company and he is giving the presentation, he is talking about something. We get the opportunity to interact with the person.
Yes, you get an opportunity to interact with the person. Please, thank you. So what I will do after this wonderful speech which we had before me, full of energy, I was thinking, what is it that I should talk to you about? And world is large, and time, of course, is specific. It's 1:10 now, and should I end at what time? Any desired time? Today, tomorrow, day after? My wish?
Yes, sir.
My goodness. Okay. So it's, I think, a 45 minutes would be fair. So take your clock at around 2 o'clock. You should break for lunch. And let's see whether in 45 minutes, how you are placed at 1:10, whether you are better placed at 2 p.m. That's a great challenge, isn't it? That whether you are better placed after 50 minutes of my talk. And I would like to have some question answered. And you can, of course, raise your hand and ask any questions you want, because it's nice to be having interactive, as he said, rather than being a monologue. It's good to be having a dialogue. All of us know that world is round, isn't it? Who do you know how the whole world round came? It actually came when Christopher Columbus, in 1492, he is an Italian. I hope you know that. He is an Italian. And the Spanish Dutch king used to sponsor him. And basically, he was a conqueror. He used to go and settle in places and hopefully conquer that place in some form, not through war. But he was an explorer, and then he would find his fellow countrymen go and occupy those spaces. So he started from mainland Europe towards, he said, I'm going east. And once I go east, I'll be able to find India. So unfortunately, he did not go, and he started going west. So what he said, if I go west, if I go round, I will find India, because world is round, that's what he said. But obviously, because he went west from Spain, he did not find India. What he found? He found land. And that's at 1492, the world got this concept of world is round. Ladies and gentlemen, actually, the world is not round. The world is flat. The world is indeed flat. And I will explain to you as to why the world is flat. And that's huge phenomenon which is happening in the world, that whenever, many other times that when U.S. has a cold, far away, thousands of kilometers away, we shall catch fever. Between 1492, which is the day when America was discovered, till 1800, the world was getting smaller through discoveries. That means newer and newer land was being discovered, newer and newer land was getting occupied. Between 1800 and 2000, which is the 200 years, the world became smaller, more smaller. Between 1800 and 2000, when companies like East India Company started imposing their authority in various parts of the world. For instance, England used to rule India, so obviously the world shrank. Previous to that, India could not be thought to be ruled by someone who's 1,000 kilometers away, but so happened, 250 years, we were ruled by someone else. 200 years. Then between year 2000 till 2010, the world became more smaller through individual actions. These inventions took place, you know, lots of, for instance, all the technological gadgets which we are using were invented and discovered, actually more invented, between 2000 and 2010. From 2010 onwards, the world has shrunk much more through these technological breakthroughs of internet, Facebook, all that what we are talking about. So if you see the world, whenever you talk about the globe, you will see between 1492 and 1500 to 1800, some developments took place. 1800 to 2000, certain other developments took place. Between 2000 and 2010, some more development took place. And from 2010 onwards, things have started differently panning out for all of us. And I have not still told you that world is flat or not, but the fact that the world has shrunk, and is it becoming flat, I'll explain to you later. I want to share with you, and I know that in another few months' time, most of you will be appearing for interviews, and therefore it's good to know certain concepts which is happening in the corporate world, which as students of business, you may not be reading as much. One concept I want to state with is, I will share with you new concepts and see whether you can understand, you can learn something from it. The world of business, the world of business should not necessarily be of, I'm an HR person, so my world of business is HR. I'm a marketing guy, so my world of business is marketing, or sales. Or I'm a finance guy, I don't only understand accounting. Or for the matter, you're an IT guy, I would only need IT. At the end of the day, when you are a business person, when you are an employee or in the corporate world, you need to do business. And business is all about money. If you make more money, it makes sense. That means your business is perfect. One concept is that if you have money, if you have surplus money with you, let us say you have 1 lakh rupees, what will you do? You know, I would spend about, let's say, 40,000 rupees per month. The balance 60,000 rupees, what will you do? You earn 1 lakh rupees. You spend 40,000. What will you do with the balance 60,000?
Save.
You will save. Where will you save? What will you do? You will keep it on the carpet, under your bed, or you will keep it in the bank. All right? When you keep it in the bank, what will the bank give you?
Interest.
Why do you keep it in the bank? Because you know, if I have 60,000 rupees, if I keep it in the bank, I'll get some money in return, I'll get some interest. Let us assume you get 10% interest. So on 60,000 every year, you will get 6,000 rupees. So the next year, the 60,000 will become 66,000. This is the way you have been taught. This is the way you have learned. And this is the way you think. Ladies and gentlemen, my dear friends, it's a fact. The world does not have positive interest. There is no negative interest. There are now negative rates of interest, which means that if you put money in your bank, you have to pay to the bank to keep your money. I don't know whether non-finance guys or ladies and gentlemen have heard about it, but there are 5 countries at least in the world, it is just spreading, that there is negative rates of interest prevalent, including Japan. Which means that if you keep money in the bank, you have to pay money to the bank. If you borrow from the bank will give you money. That's called negative interest. You don't pay money, you get money. You will ask, why is it so? You know, the world goes through upheavals, ups and downs. And the world is going through some upheavals now. And economists and politicians don't know what is the solution that will heal to bukhar hai, this sickness? What is the antibiotic? They don't know. So one of the medicine or one of the antibiotic is negative recurrence. What does it mean? That if you have money with you, which is at 60,000 rupees, and if you have to put the money in the bank, you have to pay the money to the bank. Of course, you will not put the money into the bank. So what will you do? You will spend the money. You will spend because might as well spend it. So when you spend the money, that spending, obviously someone has to produce it. So if someone produces it, you are spending, there is more activity. More activity means more employment. More employment means that person is going to earn income, and then he or she is going to spend more, and then more employment, and the cycle of employment and manufacturing starts. The logic of negative interest is to enhance manufacturing, enhance production, enhance employment. Good, bad, or ugly, only time will say, no one knows in the world till now that is this the right thing to do. If it was the right thing to do, the whole world would got into negative interest rates. But the fact of the matter is, certain countries, certain politicians, certain group of economists believe that the negative rate of interest is good. This is concept number one I want to share with you. Have you all understood negative rate of interest?
Yes, sir.
Very important, because you may or may not learn, or may not you may not be focusing on it while you are doing your studies, but this is something which all of us should be aware of, because that's a significant development which is taking place in the world of business today. The second concept I want to give is, all of us, all of you, have in your pocket something called money. And where does the money come from? All of you have got some money, am I right? And where does the money come from? The money has come, of course, from the banks, but it has been generated and guaranteed by the government of the country. Which means if you have a 100 rupee note, you will see that the government of that country, in our case the Reserve Bank of India, the government of India, has given you the promise that whatever happens, a piece of paper is worth 100 rupees equivalent goods or services. That means there is a guarantee of every money which you have, guarantee of the government, that you shall get that guaranteed amount whenever you want. The government is going to give you the amount which is written on the paper. World has changed. The world doesn't have money anymore, only money anymore from the government. Now there are privatized money. Have you heard of that? Money which is not guaranteed by the government, money which is not prepared by the government, central banks, or for the matter, air bankers, or the mint of the country. The government is private, the money is privately produced. And a name which you may have heard is Bitcoins. Have you heard of Bitcoins?
Yes, sir.
Bitcoin is money. Bitcoin is money. Money not produced by the government. Money not not authorized by the government. Then what is Bitcoin? Bitcoin is a cryptocurrency. A currency which is prepared to the computerized algorithm system. Now, what is Bitcoin? What happens with Bitcoin? Let us say I give you one Bitcoin. And you spend that Bitcoin somewhere. Whenever there is a Bitcoin, because it has not been produced by the government, there is no audit trail from where the money has come. Nobody will know. Nobody knows what is the source of Bitcoin. Because it is not from the government. If I have 100 rupees in my pocket, or if you have 100 rupees in your pocket, you spend that 100 rupees, I can ask you 100 rupees, kahan se mila? You will say, "Arey, wo to, that 100 rupees I got change at the Naka." Okay, then I go to Naka, and I found out, "Aapko 100 rupees kahan se mila?" "Oh, I got it from a car, which was passing." I go to the car, "Aap kahan se mila?" "I got from my salary." "Salary kahan se mila?" "I got the employer." "Employer ka paisa kahan se mila?" See, I can trace back. There is a traceability. Whenever there is a government currency, there is traceability. Naturally, because if you go back, maybe whatever, 2, 3, 4 years, you will find it was manufactured in a mint in India, somewhere. When it comes to Bitcoin, there is no traceability. No one knows from where the money has come from, and no one can know where the money has come from. What's the purpose of Bitcoin? The purpose of Bitcoin is, if you have a currency which is not traceable, I can use the currency for dealing in drugs, terrorism, arms and ammunition, every illegal, incorrect activity I can do, and no one will catch me, because it's outside the government system. There are companies in the world who accept Bitcoins. There are, for instance, you can actually buy an air ticket from Aer Lingus if you pay Bitcoins. You say, no, I accept Bitcoins, no problem. A significant change in the world of business. Money, which is being dealt with, need not necessarily be made, manufactured, controlled by the government of the country. Have you understood how significant is this development? And there are other Bitcoin. Bitcoin is just one type of so-called cryptocurrency money, which is non-identifiable money from the source itself. There are other Bitcoin types which are available in the world. Anyone can put together a cryptocurrency concept through an algorithmic method, prepare and produce these currencies and give a name. Concept number two, money, which all of us have heard must be prepared by the government, does not necessarily exist in war. That was concept number two. Have you understood?
Yes, sir.
Concept number one. What was concept number one? Sorry? Concept number one was, we always have heard that you get interest if you keep money in the bank, but perhaps you have not heard you can pay money to the bank to keep your money. So that's called negative rate of interest. The concept number two is, money need not necessarily be in the world manufactured and produced and controlled by the government of the country. Very significant development. Concept number three. I'm trying to give you concepts which perhaps which I would think and I thought that you may not have been exposed to as much in the past. The third, all of you have heard of China. All of you think it's a big country, it is doing perhaps all bad things, some good things. China is in big competition to India. China is moving faster, India is not moving faster as much. But a significant development, it has happened, I must tell you, it has happened in the world of business. On 1st of September this year, a government which is bankrupt, or a government which needs money, you know, you can borrow from the international sources. That's from IMF, World Bank. Let's say government of India was not doing well, you can borrow money from IMF or international money from the world. What currency do you borrow in? When the governments borrow from these international monetary bodies, what is the currency in which these money is given? Do you know that?
SDR. SDR.
SDR. Perfect. Special drawing rights. The money is not borrowed in dollar. Money is not dollar in yen, but it is drawn in SDRs. SDR is a currency which is based upon five currencies in the world, which includes dollar, Australian, euro, yen, Japanese yen. Now, from 1st of September 2016, Chinese yuan, or Chinese renminbi, is one of those currencies on which SDRs will be benchmarked. An 11% weightage will be given to to the Chinese currency while determining the value of an SDR. Please understand, it is a significant development in the world. Indian currency is not there. Chinese currency is there. The Chinese currency, of course, why 11%? Because around 11 to 12% of the world trade is in China has about 11 to 12% of the world trade going in and out of the country. Therefore, if tomorrow Libya, which is a country which is perhaps terrorist country, if I may say in a negative term, if Libya wants to borrow money, dollar he will not get, pound he will not get, euro he will not get, but if he gets Chinese currency, he gets an international recognized currency, and with that he can exchange with SDR, and then Libya gets money. A significant, I'm not sure, if you're not a student of finance, doesn't matter, but what is important is, given this fact that the Chinese currency is now part of SDR, China has moved several steps ahead of our country in terms of global power. Overnight, forget about their export-import, forget about their product is good or bad, forget about that they are larger in terms, but this fact of SDRization has significantly changed the world of business from this month of this month. That was concept number three. Now China is China, China is what it is, but the concept of their currency forming part of SDR is a significant development which you and me must now start remembering and taking it off. So negative rate of interest, Bitcoin is non-authorized currency. And the third concept is China moving up the ladder of the world through SDRization of their currency. Any questions till now? Now, it only shows the lunch is coming. And it only shows the hindrance which I am creating between you and lunch. Of course, unfortunately, someone has to speak before lunch, and the man will fail on me this time. But be as it may, having come all the way, I thought I must share one or two other concepts, which will hopefully help you when you go into the real world, and of course, read the Economic newspaper. Yes, all of you should read the Economic newspaper. It's not the Economic Times, that's just one of those Economic newspapers, but every day, please do, my dear friends, read an Economic newspaper. If you are an analytical type, then Mint is very good. It's a very good analytical newspaper. If you are a newspaper reader who wants little light news, economic news reading, then I think Business Standard or Financial Express is fine. And Economic Times, if you want to know a little bit of corporate news, little masala, Economic Times is nice. Each newspaper's financial newspaper has some pluses and minuses. All of them are good. Having said that, the fourth concept. Let us assume you are, of course, global business people, you will be in the global world very soon, and you get a job, let us assume, in Latvia. You get a job in Latvia, Eastern. You can, right? You can. Poland, Czechoslovakia, Latvia, Romania, not Romania, Hungary. There are corporates who take Indian students, Indian employees. And you go there, be it finance or be it non-finance, that company, and you go to Latvia, they give you their annual report. What does annual report contain? Annual report contains how is the company doing, which is called the profit and loss account and balance sheet. All of you heard of this word, profit and loss account, balance sheet?
Yes, sir.
Oh, thank you. That's nice. That's brilliant. Before lunch, you know, to remind you about profit and loss and balance sheet. I'm quite sure if you're non-accounting, non-finance people must be hating me.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I don't understand how this accounting gets prepared, but it is not important to know how to prepare it. What is important to know, how to read it. As long as you can read and believe me, ladies and gentlemen, you must be able to read a profit and loss account and balance sheet. If you cannot, that will remain a significant IQ issue throughout your life. You may be the most intelligent guy, but you're not able to read a balance sheet about Mr. Gandhi. It's a big, big hindrance. So please try to read it. It is not important to prepare it. Then those accounting guys, the finance guys will do it for you. Having said that, you are in Latvia. You join an employer, and you say, this is my annual report. I am not earning as much profit. You are, let's say, Miss Neha. And yeah, could you suggest what is to be done to make this company, which is not earning profits, into not earning profits and make some profits? But Latvia, first of all, language. It can be in the local language. Assuming they give you an English language, they transfer it and give it to you. Then what do you do? A balance sheet in Latvia and the profit in Latvia, which we are showing, need not necessarily be the profit is shown in English. If I ask you a question, can anyone of you define what is profit? What is profit? What is profit?
Selling price.
Expense minus income. Income minus expense. That's okay. That's okay. That's perfect. Income minus expense. That's profit. All of you agree?
Yes.
Come. That's not true. See, profit, if I now say, is profit before tax, after tax? Not defined. You did not say so. Profit before interest, after interest? Not defined. You did not say so. Profit before depreciation, after depreciation? Not defined. You have not said so. Gross profit, net profit, which profit? Have you not heard of gross profit, net profit?
Yes, sir.
What problem is your financial world, these finance guys, it's all life miserable for you anyway. Simple things, they will make it complicated. Profit pay definition, Jadana. If you say, I am sick, sick the definition, Jadana, sick, sick means sick, man. This will get definition to also tell. But a profit, the both have I. It's a fact. The definition of profit is not universally defined. One. Number two, the method of man preparing profit or deriving the profit varies from country to country. A German profit is not same as Indian profit, not same as US profit, obviously not same as Latvian profit. That thing is changing. Globally, the world is slowly adapting to international accounting system. And this international accounting system, which is now globally getting slow and slowly are getting accepted in short, it's called the IFRS concept, which accounting guys would have heard it. Even non-accountant, please, I'm again telling you, whether you are an HR guy or an IT or a finance guy, you must know what is profit and loss balance sheet and the report. And you must be able to interpret it. If you don't know, please spend your time, tell your fellow students, fellow colleagues, to teach you explain. Very important. It's a things to do list. Now, in India also, fortunately, this year, you must have heard a new standard has come called IND. IND means IND, it's India. AS, IND AS, called Indian Accounting Standards. The Indian Accounting Standard, you know, when you read it, you have read something called Indian GAAP. Generally,
accepted accounting principles.
Yeah. That GAAP is a general accounting principle, but now India has IND-AS, this is called Indian Accounting Standard. This IND-AS is very close to the global accounting standard, which basically means that even India has now adapted and adopted global concept of defining profit. There is a profit defined together. What should be deducted? What should not be deducted? For instance, I know I'm speaking to a business class, business school, all guys. Let us assume you want to derive the profit of a company on 31st of March on 2017. It's 31st of March 2017. And you have sold goods in February to Russia. Sold goods to Russia in Russian ruble. Let us assume you have sold Russian ruble worth 1 lakh in the month of February in 2017. on 31st of March, what is the value of the currency will you pay in the books? If the value of the currency is strong, then of course your profits will be higher or lower, or value of currency is weaker. Now, Ind AS, I know I'm getting into accounting terms, please don't bother about accounting terms. The bottom line is that the Ind AS, or for the matter, international accounting systems now tell you exactly how to treat and export or import in foreign currency on an annual financial year. They will tell you. Therefore, whether it's Latvia, Hungary, Belgium, US, Germany, India, the profit will have the same definition. World is becoming flat. Have you understood?
Yes, sir.
World is distinctly becoming flat. And little understanding of Ind AS, you don't need to know anything, but just to understand, this year they have adopted already, for all the companies which has net worth, not network, net worth of more than 500 crores. And so that's adopted, and other listed companies will adopt in the next year. This is an important development. I started with this problem question of the world is flat. Now, flat. Do you remember that?
Yes.
I do understand. Lunch is coming, so maybe you have already forgotten what I started with. I did mention that I need to explain to a little bit this world is flat. I want to tell you a story. An interesting story. A story which... Some interest still left?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, some of you do, I think. You're at 145 interest gets lost, but when I say story, maybe all of you think, okay, story to sun lete hai, uske baad to khana milega. So why not hear the story? Let me tell you a story. I told you the world is flat, and see how world flat is, how world flat is. Over a period of, if you get about 5 to 7 minutes, to tell you the story. It will sound complicated, but it is actually not. So if you hear, I think you will understand a great concept. In the year, in the late 1990s, 1970, 1980, US followed a concept of housing for everyone, housing for all Americans. Every American must have a home. That's a policy they follow. And the US, as you know, is a capitalist economy. How will everyone get a home? Now, government is not going to construct home for them, unlike China, which is, China, by the way, is not communistic. It is also as capitalistic. It is only that it's one party rule, which is dictatorial. There's no democracy there. But there is no communism anymore. But having said that, in the US, they say everyone must have a home. In order to get everyone must get a home, the government started encouraging the bankers to give home loans. So every bank was there, come on, give home loans, and people must borrow and construct or build a home. Fantastic. Now, where did the bank give loans? The banks will give loans to those people who have the ability to repay. But if it is home for everyone, I have to give loans to people who does not have the ability to repay. That has to happen. So banks say they're trying to give loans. Banks continue to give loans to people who do not have the ability to repay. But because the banks were giving loans, people were buying houses, and the home prices were going up. Kept on going up, slowly. The banks say, what if the home price is going up, and the people to whom I have lent cannot repay me, no problem, I will take charge of home and pay and make a profit. Let us assume that when I gave the loan, the house was 10 lakhs. After 3 years, the house was worth 12 lakhs. And if this fellow cannot repay, I will sell it at 12 lakhs, I'll make 2 lakhs profit. So it was working perfect. So people started getting loans, banks started giving loans. But the banks thought that the loans which I'm giving, I'm giving to people who does not have the ability to repay. Very important. If you don't have the ability to repay, this loan was called subprime mortgage loan. What is subprime mortgage loan, a loan was given against mortgage or property. Because when you give the loan, the house which that loan taker takes will be mortgaged. It's a mortgage loan. Whenever you take a loan, you have to give something. I hope you know that.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So only perhaps in certain cases, some banks will give you a house. Education loan, that even education loan, they will ask you some security. So without security, loan nahi hota. In housing, the house itself is a security. But because the loan takers were not able to repay or their ability to repay was low, it was used to call subprime mortgage loan. This is a word which I hope you have read it somewhere. As you have not read, this is the concept. The banks used to give subprime mortgage loans. The banks also had prime mortgage loans. That means they genuinely had some good loans. But 90% of the loans which the banks were giving were subprime. And the banks knew, they are intelligent people, they know that ye jo loan hum diye hue hain, the ability to get it back is very low. So the banks were sitting on their balance sheet with loans which they are given, which need not be repaid. So they say, इसको हमारा किताब से निकालना चाहिए. Somehow I must push it out from my balance sheet. Have you understood?
Yes.
All of you say you understand balance sheet, right?
Yes.
Okay. Even if you don't, better go and understand what balance sheet. Surely, slowly but surely. Having said that, these people had loans sitting on their balance sheet, which were subprime. Now, literally, was the banks did. The banks took all these subprime mortgage loans, which was about 90%. They added some prime loans, banks loans given to good people, like you and me, you know, they're good people, good loans, prime loans. And they mixed it together, literally. Khichdi banaya usko. And once they made the khichdi, this khichdi, then they say, this is a product which is completely mixed with subprime and prime mortgage loans. They then went to a rating agency. They got that product rated by Moody's and S&P's. And Moody's and S&P's, of course, there was some underlying and transaction fraudulent practices. They said, ye to mortgage hai, iske piche to ghar hai, and the house price is going up. So therefore, they gave AAA rating. AAA is the highest rating. AAA, AA, single A. I hope you have heard that.
Double B.
The lowest is D. D is default. They got the AAA rating, which is risk-free. It's a risk-free loan. Then they went to an insurance company called AIG. And AIG ko bola, iski insure karo. AIG bola, theek hai, AAA rated hai. Aur humko premium milta hai, jab insure kar denge. Because everyone cannot go bust, hopefully not, so I will make money. They got insured. Then they went to some government banks called Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae. I have heard these names. These are government guaranteed banks. They got it, some his khichdi also guaranteed by the banks. So what these banks did, JP Morgan, Morgan Stanley, Bank of America, Citibank, they took these papers, which is mixture of mortgage and subprime, rated AAA, backed by insurance policy, and perhaps guaranteed by some semi-government banks. And then they went all over the world, said, yeah, hamare paas ek paper aap lenge, to the various banks. The banks who were doing it, the American banks, knew these papers were worth toilet paper. They knew about it. It actually came to ICICI Bank also. So ICICI Bank picked up some papers like that. All over the world, hundreds, billions of dollars of these loans were sold by the American banks all over the world. Everyone picked up. From 2007, around that point of time, some American banks say, you know, theek hai, these are subprime or banks, let's call some loans back also. These loans, whether they will be repaid. So when they went and called for the loans, they found they have no ability to pay. So what did these people do who have no ability to pay? This is my ghar level. What did the banks do with the ghar? What will they do? They will go and sell the house and recover the money. So from a situation where there was a demand for houses, suddenly there was supply of houses because the banks started selling the houses to recover the loan. The moment they started selling the houses to recover the loan, the house prices collapsed. The moment the house prices collapsed, the so-called mortgage loans, which was what Kichuri and sold all over the world, the property behind it was worth toilet paper. In any case, it was supposed to have been worth toilet paper. It got confirmed it is toilet paper. See, banks like ICICI Bank or other banks all over the world, they were sitting on this piece of papers, which is obviously not worth anything. So what did they do? To cut losses? Well, okay, abhi cut loss karna padega. So I am not giving any more loans. So the banking system, in order to cut losses from these papers which they got all from these American banks, they, in order to cut the losses, think about it, they stopped giving for the loans. Very important. The banking system in the world in 2008 stopped giving for the loans. When they stopped giving for the loans, the whole industry, the world thrives and depends on loans, and that is money. So the industrialists, the service providers need more money. And the money, the oxygen, money is called oxygen. Oxygen was removed, and when the oxygen was removed, the world collapsed, and the 2008 financial crisis, which is called the recession, started because of this economic fraud created and constructed by the American banks in 2007 and 2004. Is not the world in flat? The world, the global recession of 2008 was a manifestation of an economic fraud, of a corporate fraud created by the banking system of the USA. Have you understood this?
Yes, sir.
So while the world looks round, more and more you will think the world is flat. World is flat means the world has shrunk. Not only through your television, internet, Facebook, LinkedIn, and all that, but literally speaking, when you swipe your card wherever in the world, let's say an American swipes his card in New York, the chances are that transaction will be settled in Bangalore or Pune. Right? This we all know, we all know the back office concept and so on and so forth. Okay, so it's 2:55, actually 2:56. I have told you 5 concepts. I hope you have understood this concept.
Yes,
but let's take some questions, because otherwise I'll go on and on. As I said, we can go till tomorrow morning if required. But one more small thing that you, the ladies and gentlemen, when you go to the real world, you should realize the world has changed so much that jobs got into green energy, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, are now actually booming. So when you go, you are all looking for Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Hindustan, Unilever, chances are that those jobs would be missing. These jobs for the so-called startups are those domains. But another 2 domains, ladies and gentlemen, is opening up is how to enhance the lifespan. You know, now the lifespan of the world is around 80. The global scientists are now working towards how to make it 110, 120. So how to enhance the lifespan is another huge industry which is emerging. Another industry which is emerging, and you must realize, is how to change the color of the skin. The film, the white people lie without clothes on the beach to turn their skin gray or dark or tan. We, the dark people, are trying to use fairness creams to make our skin different, fair. So none of us are happy. The world population historically has never been happy with the color of the skin. All of us are wanting to reverse the color of the skin. It's a huge industry, which is again opening up. It's only there, fair and lovely products like that, but it's booming actually. And another issue is this artificial intelligence, whether that's another area which is going to attract talents like you. So please do not go by the books which is saying, okay, jobs for Siemens is what I should look for. Jobs for Coca-Cola and Pepsi is what I should look for. The job scene, the job profile is changing so significantly that all of us need to be prepared both mentally and, of course, IQ and SQ and EQ levels as to how to be useful for these jobs. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, questions? It is, I don't know, it's 5:52. of course, you should not face me.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Sumit Kumar Modi. I'm from DHRD Marketing. Sir, as you have written Who Cheats and How, recently I was reading about one company and I was going through its balance sheet also. What I came to find that 23,000 crore of debt from total 22 banks. I don't want to name the bank, name the company. When I was reading about the reasons for behind that, and when I asked the person about that, they said they gave the reason that they had the instant desire in the globe. So, at one hand, this happened. What happened with Vijay Mallya is also known to everyone. But at the zero level, when we take loan from a bank, for example, I take education loan from SBI, so every semester they have to take my marksheet to check my performance so that whether I'm eligible for giving them the loan back. Sir, do you think the banking industry in India is really doing ethical kind of business? And if it's not ethical, then what kind of measures that government and industries body like CII is performing to check that measure? Because lots of 23,000 crore debt is the capitalization of the company itself.
Okay. By the way, I must tell you one thing I forgot to tell you. That khichdi which was made for making a loan, it's called CDO, collateralized debt obligation. So there is a name attributed to that, CDO, collateralized debt obligation. So I think I did not mention that name. Okay, having said that, the question here is, the banks in India are sitting on crores of debt, and debt seems to be not recoverable. Am I right? That's the question. They seem to be not recoverable, and of course, businessmen like Vijay Mallya actually is able to fly off from the country and not be in the debt. Is it something to do with ethics? The answer is yes, it is something to do with ethics. What has happened? Whenever a loan is given to someone, you give loan for a purpose. For instance, I take a loan. Let's say you take a loan for buying a car. You are supposed to buy a car. But with a loan, you are not supposed to buy a home. With that loan or the car loan, you are not supposed to go on holiday. If you buy a house, at least there is a property. But you took a car loan and you go on a holiday. That's incorrect. That is what has happened. The loans taken were misutilized for the purpose which it was taken. Number one. Number two, the mortgages which were being given against the loans given were also misdeclared. For instance, I take a loan of, let us assume, 50 crores, and I say with 50 crores, I will put up a steel plant. And for that 50 crore steel plant, I will put my 20 crores, and therefore there is a 70 crore steel plant, 50 crore from the bank, 20 crore from my money, 70 crores. If the bank, tomorrow I am not able to return the money to the bank can take over the 70 crore steel plant and recover their 50 crores. Now what if with that 50 crore money, I can do two things. I don't recoup my 20 crores, although I told you I will. Number two, from the 50 crore, I put up 45 crore worth of steel plant. So when I'm not able to repay the loan, what will bank see? Bank sees, you have declared 70 crores worth of steel plant. You have taken 50 crores from me. Actually, I have a steel plant of 45 crores only. This is what has happened. Literally speaking, this is what has happened. The third thing what has happened in the past, that the loan defaults were also in the past. The loan defaults are not happening only now. But what used to happen earlier, when the loan was defaulted, when the industrialist was not able to repay the loans, the bank is to give fresh loans to repay the old loans, which is called evergreening. So evergreening is to take place. Now the Reserve Bank of India said you can't do evergreening anymore. So because you can't get new loan to repay the old loan has become bad. It has become open in the public domain. That is what has happened. Big corporate scam. It's a fact.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Gaurav from BIM Marketing Batch. So you talked about Chinese economy, Iran being included in SDR, and also touched upon the Communist Party. So my question is, don't you think China has been living in a bubble where it is being ruled by the Communist Party and also has been exercising its rights lands like Tibet and Taiwan,
And recently, Taiwan's newly elected president has voted to decrease its dependence on Beijing, wherein, in response, Beijing issued a warning to her not to seek independence. Do you think it is on the line of USSR, which was once a superpower, and now 15 odd countries have broken down, and we, on a different track, are more politically stable?
Let me answer this Chinese question. Believe me, ladies and gentlemen. The world wants to do what? The world wants to make everyone happy. How do you do happy? What, how do you make people happy? By increasing the per capita income. This whole happiness index that seeking is happiest and all that, forget. Happiness index, I don't know how you can make people happy, but you have to enhance the per capita income. The political world and economists does not know the best way to enhance the per capita income. I will not get into what the possible options are, but one of the options of per capita enhancement is a Chinese government. Good, bad, and ugly, only time will say. Good, bad, and ugly, it's up to you to decide. China does not follow democracy. China follows autocracy. China is a world party rule. It does not follow communism anymore, it follows capitalism. This is the factual position. I was in China, I go to China very often. I was in China about 1.5 years back. In my nearby office, I was there 6 months before. And where my office was, there I find the multi-story building. And I said, have we changed my office? There was a huge village, well, not village, but a shanty. But it's a multi-story building again. So I thought actually our office would have changed. He said, no, the shanty is gone, a new office place has come now. What has happened? The shanty people, there were 500 of them apparently, they were shunted away some 120 or 150 kilometers. With saying, Abhi udar jake rahega. With little compensation. Nobody can say a word. Now, what has happened? This is in Beijing, by the way. Beautiful building has come up. People over there got shunted 120 kilometers away. No noise. Nobody can say anything. Is it good or bad? I don't know. No. Don't know. As far as you are concerned, you got it. If you are staying in Beijing, it's perfect. You've got lovely, lovely buildings, lovely place, infrastructure. Bad. Because people are being shunted away without perhaps being responsible for them. It's like dams. You know, dam is constructed, what happens to people before the dam and after the dam. Is dam good? Because dam provides water to hundreds of thousands of people. But what do? You offend some people. Good or bad? Time will say, no answer. But this is what is happening in China. Is China doing ethically what they're doing? They are saying, I am doing best for the country. GDP of the country is going up, per capita is going up, people are becoming happy, that's a policy I follow. Which means, in order to enhance the per capita income, if I have to kick some few people down, I shall do that. That's a policy. Good and bad? No one knows. Believe me, no one knows. If that was good, everyone in the world would have followed. Because it's bad, sometimes, or at least some of us feel, many people don't follow, many countries don't follow. That's how it is.
Sir? Sir, why do China devaluate its currency?
To encourage exports. To encourage exports.
Every time we devaluate against only dollar.
China changes the currency. China's any currency. Today, $1 is equivalent to 66 rupees. 66 rupees, 30 paise. That has assumed 66 rupees. It was 67 rupees 1 month back. It was 69 rupees 6 months back. Now it is 66 rupees. Why? Because demand supply of dollar and rupee. So if more dollar is coming to the country, there are FII investments, as you know. So therefore, Indian rupee is strengthening. A dollar, for getting $1, used to pay 69 rupees earlier. Now to get $1, if I pay 66, it is enough. So more dollar comes in. The dollar demand goes up, rupee demands goes up, therefore the rupee strengthens. So the issue of currency rate is a matter of demand supply. However, China is a classical case where they alter their currency based on their own, their central bank, which is Reserve Bank of India equivalent, their central bank buys Chinese yuan or sells Chinese yuan. And by doing that, they actually impact the demand supply of the dollar and their own currency. That's what they do. When they feel that exports should be encouraged, they will do that. weaken their currency. When they think imports should be curtailed or imports should be curtailed, they will strengthen the currency. So time to time, based on their own little interest, they play around with the currency. They can play around because China is sitting on some, I think, the total currency reserve they are sitting on, I think it's $5 or $6 trillion. They are sitting on the currency. India's total reserve is $350 billion. And $1,000 billion is $1 trillion. India's total national GDP is $1.8 trillion. So China's foreign currency they're holding out is more than the India's GDP. So they're having so much foreign currency, they can buy and sell as long as they can do, they will do. There was a question, is China a bubble? I think it is.
That was the last question. Thank you so much, sir. We are
I wish you great success, and I'm always available. Whenever you think you need any help, please do let me know. And my numbers, my contacts are available at the Institute. God bless you all. It's always nice to come and speak to such a lovely gathering. I'm happy that not many are seated. Thank you.
We are delighted by the work of your wisdom, sir, and we look forward to many more such interactions on and off the campus.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Dr. Archana Srivastava, Director in Charge BIMM, to present memento to Mr. Robinson.